The historian Edward Gibbon once wrote, "The Ethiopians slept near 1,000 years, forgetful of the world by whom they were forgotten." Today, for many reasons, Ethiopians are dispersed throughout the world. There are 30,000 here in Washington alone. In Washington's Ethiopian quarter, Asted Awerka sings to her people. For the first time in their history, Ethiopians know the experience of exile.
I think most people think of my country as a place of famine and a civil war. They only know it through television news and the newspaper headlines. But like anywhere else in the world, there's another side to my country, a more enduring side, because we are a people with a long, long history.
If you see an Ethiopian nonahi in a vast landscape and plays these simple instruments, seemingly such monotonous notes, there is nothing that transports the Ethiopian soul to the highest of images that you can imagine. It lifts you up, it transports you, it is pure poetry.
Ethiopia is a mosaic of peoples, 75 different nations in all, with their own traditions and cultures. But its contemporary music derives from the country's heartland, the so-called Central Highlands, the music of the Amara, the Tigrinya, the Gurage, and the Oromo. These highland people are the dominating influence on today's city music. Nawai de Berber, idol of a younger generation, grew up in the country. He once tended his grandfather's herd. At Ethiopian television, they're recording to playback one of his romantic songs, full of pastoral imagery. His regular venue is the Addis Ababa Hilton. Here he sings with one of the most versatile bands in the country, Roja. Nowai writes his own material. This is not unusual. It's part of a long and vigorous tradition in Ethiopia.
I would say the Ethiopian always sings at his heart, in his heart. He's a poet at heart. He is a singer at heart.
As elsewhere, most pop songs are about love. But there are differences.
You know, the Ethiopian is very discreetly romantic, quiet, shy, but then it is so much muted inside his heart.
Netsanet Melesa, one of the kindest, best-loved artists in the business, sings with the Walias band. She started as a choir girl in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Popular music in Ethiopia draws on two traditional sources, the sacred and the secular. The secular influence is that of the Amaris, or troubadours. They performed in the courts of nobles and in the drinking houses of the common people. Nowadays, these drinking houses are often simply a converted room in somebody's home. One of the friendliest in town is that of Abebech Derara. Ababich usually sings her own songs, improvising to suit her audience. She explains why to club owner Yobda Haile Mariam Gesese.
Gun ለራሱን የነካው ዘፈን ምናካው ነበር
ሀዘን ሀዘን
ሀዘን ከደረሰብሽ ነው በደ ምዘፍ ዘፈን ከነነ ለኔ እንደምመስለው ዘፈን ምዘፍ ነው ዘፈን ከሱዩት ጋር የተገናኘ ሲሆን ይበለጥ ያምርለታል ወተሻል አርቲፊሻል ሆኖ አይቀርም ናለኝ ግራውድ ማምለ
Her background is theater, but she engages and challenges her audience like a true Asmani. Most Asmaris were men without formal schooling, yet emperors and nobles feared their devastating barbs. Of the few who remain, one of the best is Bahiru.
He reflected the dreams and the aspirations, the laughter and the tears of the people. He cannot be otherwise. He takes it from the people and he reinterprets with his talent what the people already know about themselves.
በራስ የለገምኩኝ ሰው መላኬን ትቼ እንንየው ባዘገምኩኝ ይህንንን ያንለ ኧረ እንደምንድነሽ ይደንልንን እነሰው ይናገሩት እነሰው ይናገራል እንዲያው ና አንቺናኔ በነገናኝሻል ጎረቤት ቢከፋ ይሰራል ብቻ ጥቁር በሬ ቢሞት ይገዛል ዳልቻ አጣሁኝ መድኃኒት እናሳባቂ ብቻን እናጣሁኝ መድኃኒት እናሳባቂ ብቻ ያንቺን ነገር ነኔ የኔ ነገር ናንቺ የሚያመላልሰው የታል ደሞዙ ልብሱን የለበሰው
Now, gradually, they are making their exit. For me, sadly so, because I still try to go around and to listen to them. They give a lot of contemporary information through their music in a very entertaining manner. I think it will take some years before they will be completely out, sadly completely out.
The other influence on Ethiopian popular music is that of the church. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church is traditionalist, hierarchical, and strong on ritual. Its influence has been enduring and profound. It is in many ways unique.
በሰንበተ ክርስቲያን አስማታንስ አበሳልስት
In its liturgy, for instance, it has developed a form of musical notation, small symbols hatched in above the written word, that is found nowhere else. This is attributed to a holy monk called St. Yared, considered the father of Ethiopian church music.
አስቀድሞ ነብዩ ዳዊት በመዝሙር 150 እግዚአብሔርን በከበሮ በጸናጽል በእንዚራ አመስግኑት እስትንፋስ ያለው ሁሉ እግዚአብሔርን ያመስግን
Unlike other parts of Africa, this is not a Christianity brought by missionaries in recent times. Its church was established in the 4th century, some time before Christianity came to Britain. Church music and the music of the clubs and bars have two things in common. A certain underlying spirituality and the hypnotic effect of their traditional rhythms. This is a ritual and a culture that draws directly on ancient Judaic custom. And if today it has had to adapt to new deities and new rulers, the church's influence has not so much diminished, has simply become more circumspect. Today's head of state is President Mengistu Haile Mariam. He emerged after the overthrow in 1974 of the Emperor Haile Selassie. The government has adopted, in a somewhat pragmatic way, Marxist-Leninism as its ideology. For some years, the Ethiopian armed forces, now the largest in sub-Saharan Africa, have been in conflict with insurrectionary movements in Eritrea and Tigray. The human suffering has been immense, the drain on the economy crippling. According to the government's own statistics, half the nation's income goes on defense. Military assistance has come from the Soviet Union, training of its army and security forces from East Germany. North Korea has given the capital city, Addis Ababa, the benefit of its public architecture. Even the Hilton Hotel carries the ubiquitous fraternal greetings. After the terror that followed the revolution, the continuing casualties of the civil war, and a paucity of accurate information, most Ethiopians long for greater access to the world outside. Yet for all that, whenever they discuss their culture, a proud independence makes them still wary of what they call the Farenj.
Whenever any foreigner touches your what is yours, he's going to obviously implement what is his. Okay. And he's going to take so much out of you and so manipulate so much of it. And he's going to give it, this is what, you see? No, I want it to come out from an Ethiopian, an indigenous Ethiopian.
I observe a certain contradiction here. On one hand, we want our music to be palatable. And that is, I think, a euphemism. We want it to be a sellable commodity. On the other hand, we want to retain that cultural value that makes that music
unique.
Ethiopian.
Yes.
You can't eat and keep the cake. If it's going to be Ethiopian music, it's not going to be palatable.
But the point is, development, I mean, unfoldment will happen. You know, it will unfold, it will grow. And the most comforting thing about Ethiopian culture is this character that it assimilates any other culture that comes onto it with arrogance and overcomes it. Now, I don't want to keep Ethiopian music because it is Ethiopian or my allegiance to it. But imagine what could it do to pop music, which now I could listen to when I was young. I could pop music now, rock and roll, couldn't satisfy me. Because it is singular, as it were. It is unidimensional. It is only bum, bum, bum. So if Ethiopian music can bring to pop music this kind of, you know, give me something for my heart and my mind, while at the same time I'm doing, you know, great somersaults or breakdance, you know, then what a tremendous contribution, what an enrichment that would be.
Composer Mulatu Astatke calls his style of music Ethio Jazz.
That's a music which is a fusion of themes of Ethiopian music, but fused with 12-tone music. I've done quite a lot of experimental on harmonic structures and voicings, and using different rhythm elements from different parts of Ethiopia.
This composition, using church music as its inspiration, is called Lent Time. Mixing Ethiopian and European instruments, it's an example of Mulatu's attempt to create something that is modern in concept, yet Ethiopian in character. Of the dozen or so traditional instruments, there are four in common use in popular music. The washint, the kabero, the krar, and the masinko. Another influence of the past is that today's popular music often works within the parameters of the four traditional modes, or scales. The first of these is the Anchihoye. Thank you.
Unlike the other three, Anchioye is only used to express melancholic kind of mood. While the others are used to express both gear and melancholic. For example, like the Badi. As you can hear, Badi is being played now in a much more livelier mood. This is because we are using the chikchika beat. The chikchika beat is unique to Ethiopia as reggae was once to Jamaica. This is the third scale. It's called the ambassel. But now it's being played in a much more syncopated, inventive, and transformed version. The last scale or mode used in Ethiopian music is tzita. Now, if there is really something which describes our country's soul, it's this. What we're hearing is a slightly pacey version of tzita. Now, tzita has been played by a lot of Ethiopian famous singers, and it has got a lot of different versions. But if you want to hear a deeply melancholic version of the tzita, listen to the zaz.
Tzita is a recollection of the past. It is nostalgia of the past. It is nostalgia of the experiences of the past. It's, you see the past as part of an inspiration for the future. It is a love song. That a person, a man and a woman, falls in love, they sing tzita. Or a person, for example, myself, I sing tzita sometimes when I'm very happy and sometimes when I'm sad. It is one of those songs that I sing at heart. Does for me express the real musical soul of the Ethiopians. In fact, I have dedicated a painting to this song. It is symbolic, it is allegorical, as the song itself is. Now, the girl is a very beautiful one, and in the typical classical style, she is looking very sad, very disdainful. Because if a girl was smiling and laughing all the time, she was not really considered completely beautiful. In order to have the acceptance as the most beautiful woman, she had to have a tinge of sadness as well. ¶¶
Zitta is the soul song of Highland Ethiopia, then the Iskista is their special dance. Ethiopians say that it is only in the countryside, at traditional weddings for instance, that you see the real Iskista.
The movements are more created above the waist, unlike most African dances, but it is again like the song, like the music, very sophisticated, underplayed, even if it looks as if very provocative and very sexy. It is subdued and very refined in its approach.
Certainly most visitors, when first introduced to the Iskista, do see it as an extremely sexy and provocative dance.
What was it that your Shakespeare said, only thinking makes it so? You can feel sexy, you can feel any other feelings you like, but nevertheless, this has come from this czar, you know, the full letting yourself go. It's a bit of a pagan expression.
Desta Gebre has long been recognized as one of its greatest exponents.
For me, she was the most outstanding Iskista dancer because she does it from the heart, from deep down, with a tremendous amount of feeling. So it's when she dances it sometimes, you are confused between the fetish, the religious, and the sensuous.
No,
In the past, performers had little status in Ethiopia. Well-to-do families would feel ashamed if one of them became an entertainer. Today that's changed. Through government sponsorship, there are now roving cultural troupes in nearly every province of the country, and 4 state-subsidized theaters in Addis Ababa alone. At the City Hall Theater, Abata Mercuria directs his own musical about the streetwise people of the city.
My characters frequent the streets, the town dwellers, which we call the Arada people. And the Arada, this is the center of the town where everything really happens. And the characters dwelling in this particular area are exposed to foreign contacts. If a new number is created in music, they immediately take it and assimilate it to themselves. They take it, recreate it and sang it out like Shimbradubi, Shimbradubi, Aikanyimbadubi, you see? So, like the shoeshine thing. So in time it becomes folklore, contemporary folklore.
Mahmoud Ahmed is one of the few singers in Ethiopia to have achieved international recognition. He started his working life as a shoeshine boy. Here with the Roja band, he sings a gurage song. The gurage people of Ethiopia are famous for their entrepreneurial skills, whether it's hustling a living as shoeshine boys or running highly successful businesses. Here, where Marxist Leninism and private enterprise pursue a somewhat watchful coexistence, Mahmoud Ahmed runs his own thriving music shop. Today, the gurages dominate the Makato, one of the largest markets in Africa. There's a part of Addis where every other doorway opens onto a music shop. It's known as Cassette Alley. The commercial side of music making in Ethiopia is based exclusively on cassettes. There are no records, certainly no digital recordings. Cassettes are not cheap. They retail at 13 birr each, the equivalent at the official rate of about £4. A lot of money for the average Ethiopian. Yet sales have mushroomed in the past 15 years, both in spite of their cost and their quality. Cassette producer Ali Kaifa is recording with Tigrinya singer Sofia Asbeha. The band work without sound separation in one room, Sofia in a converted kitchen next door. Ali Kaifa has no illusions about these recordings.
We don't have professional or semi-professional studios to record. And we don't have also enough equipment for recording. This is why the quality of the recording is poor.
The cassette producers say this is because the government won't grant them licenses to import better equipment. The government reply they have more important priorities when allocating scarce foreign exchange. Equally worrying to Ali Kaifa is the problem of piracy.
The other shops, you know, of the music shops, when I release a new cassette of any singer, they copy it. There is no copyright here, you know.
To deal with problems like this, the government has set up the Ethiopian Music Association. Its job is to control all professional music making. It means that singers, if they want to make a cassette, have to submit both lyrics and score to the association's quality control panel. This, they explain, ensures standards are maintained and there is no plagiarism. The association has little liking for the private cassette producers. They describe them pejoratively as business musicians. They say they often cheat the recording artists. The musicians are, in fact, reasonably happy with the cassette producers. They wonder why the association itself doesn't lead the way with its own state-financed recording facility, instead of just criticizing the private sector.
Before you replace something, you must prepare the ground with what you are going to replace it. The Ethiopian musician unquestionably needs a patron. He has got to be patronized. He has got to make his living. He has to have something in order to go on in life.
Getacho Kasa sings with the Ethio Star Band at the Gion Hotel. Most singers and bands are contracted, if not to a hotel, then to a theater company, a cultural troupe, or the armed forces. Whichever way, they're state employees. The pay is not bad, relatively speaking. After tax, about £200 a month, the same as a senior civil servant. But a recording artist can earn £15,000 sterling for a cassette. It means the private cassette producer is able to lift that singer into a different financial league altogether. As in other parts of Africa, club and hotel bands in Ethiopia grew out of the military bands. The first of these was formed in the 20s, when Emperor Haile Selassie, then still regent, discovered in Jerusalem some Armenian orphans, survivors of the Turkish Holocaust. He brought them to Ethiopia and established what he called the Bodyguard Band. Avedis Tezian, senior spokesman for Ethiopia's influential Armenian community, remembers the first time these bandsmen played in public. It was at the Emperor's coronation in 1931, a debut that very nearly didn't happen. In rehearsals, they had to prepare the various national anthems of the invited foreign dignitaries.
When it came to the Turkish anthem, they refused to play. They argued, they said, we cannot play the music, the anthem of a country that has killed our parents. The emperor got angry. He said, he ordered them to continue playing. He said, it should not, their personal feelings should not interfere. This was a diplomatic show and so on. Well, they were adamant. They refused. So a big state council was invited, including the greatest chiefs of the empire. And they said, this is a problem. These boys will not play the anthem of one of our guests. They listened. Despite the emperor's insistence, the whole group unanimously decided that they could not be expected to play the music of a country that had killed their fathers.
A few years later, in 1935, Italy invaded Ethiopia. The ill-equipped Ethiopians were no match for a modern army. Within weeks, the invaders made their triumphal entry into the ruined capital. If this dream of empire was short-lived, Italy's cultural influence was to long survive its eventual military defeat. Italian dance bands became a regular feature of life in cities like Addis and Asmara. What's more, many Italians had grown to love the country. When offered repatriation to Italy at the end of the war, they chose to stay.
Poi chi c'era ancora? Sono morti tutti.
Più della metà.
Amongst them, Giulio Tartaglia and Lucenti Vincenzo.
Lombardi.
Lombardi è morto.
Morto adesso.
Lombardi è morto.
C'era lui.
Un reale, una messa alla
ministeria. No, ma c'era un gruppo. E c'era Lombardi, c'era Teghini.
Lombardi, Teghini, Reale.
Reale è venuto da te. Sì. C'era anche lui, poi c'erano i due fratelli dal Bandiera.
Lui si era innamorato di una ragazza Angelina.
Ah, quella Angelina.
Dicevano di Lombardi. Angelina che se n'era andata con un altro armeno. E lui gli diceva, Angelina, Angelina, tu sarai la mia rovina.
Ah, ma è quella poi di Lombardi.
Gaia ti ho comprato la Maccaia.
Ho capito, ma è
se
quella.
Se ritorni a me sarò contento, ti regalerò la 1100.
Te lo ricordi ancora?
Sì.
Then in the late 50s there came a revolution. It's Sunday night at the Buffet de la Gare.
It's a sort of small international cafe with all the trimmings that you find in such similar places, be it in Hong Kong, Paris or New York. You meet all kinds of people from all spectrums of life, and I think it's a kind of melting pot. I think it is good that such a place does exist in Addis, and I think to whoever goes there will get a glimpse also of what another side of Ethiopia.
Veteran singer Alamayo Eshete was famous in the 60s for his takeoffs of Presley and others.
Baby, I don't care. Baby, I don't care. Baby, I don't care. I don't care. I don't care. I don't
care. One thing which is very interesting about that place is that the music tries to be international, but at the same time, you know, this Ethiopian element creeps into it, which I think is healthy.
Since the formation of dance bands back in the 1930s, Ethiopian music has undoubtedly become more indigenous in character. There have been outside influences, of course, as well as internal pressures. As in all other aspects of cultural life, the government believes popular music must play its political role in the country's development. Sergeant Wubishar Seleshi sings with the one-time bodyguard band, now known as the 4th Revolutionary Army Band.
Lyrics cannot be, for love, such as a woman and man and woman. It's not only this. So they have to compose a lyric for, as I said, heroes of the country, for the country, for the mountain, for the river, and everything on this. Because music has to express everything what we see.
In these times of fierce intentions and uncertainty, the song of Ethiopia continues, at home or in exile, persistent and unique.
Three to zero.
healthiest sign of all for me is that the Ethiopian musicians, they are all trying to do that music that has influenced them, but with a tinge of Ethiopianness in them. In other words, they are trying to interpret it, as it were, in their Ethiopian fashion, their Ethiopian way.
Yeah,